yeah, I'm winning.
Why?
I'm winning, yeah, yeah, I'm winning.
Why?
I'm winning, yeah, yeah, I'm winning.
Why?
Rich kid asshole, paint me as a villain.
Why?
Don't be mad, cause I'm doing me better than you doing you. Don't be mad, cause I'm doing me better than you doing you. Don't be mad, cause I'm doing me better than you doing you. Better than you doing you, you.
Fuck you, what you want? Different color my passport, Instagram my stack load, hashtag my day wear, and your girl drank my daycare, and I'm born rich, life ain't fair.
Silver spoon, cool ho.
Ain't nobody sicker in my fisker room, room ho. Ain't nobody.
Until you go, oh, 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 oh. Come in misery, girl, you can't seem as old as your omens. And the mother we share will never keep your proud head from falling. The way is long, but you can make it easy on me. And the mother we share will never keep our cold heart from falling.
If there is a line I'll cross it, the lesson will.
Here, so I'm going to go right to the chase as opposed to a lot of history. That certainly shows where Daniel is today. He's been doing it for 30-odd years, started as a DJ, run numerous labels, was a radio promotion man, knows all facets of the business, now has his own company, Glassnote Records. So what does it take to get signed to Glassnote?
The easy answer is an amazing live show. It's the quickest answer. Everything you saw there was signed out of a live appearance. It wasn't the demo, it wasn't a lawyer, it wasn't an agent sending it in. It was really us seeing the band live after getting a tip or just going to see the band. But every single artist from Childish Gambino to Mumford and Sons happened out of the live. So I would say our tent pole on the left side would be the live show, the right side is the, what we do with it after, but it's the live thing.
Okay, we've gone through a wrenching transition in the music business in the last 25 years, certainly in the 15 years since Napster. You were around before that. Certainly, Chrysalis, you had a lot of credible bands. When the SBK, you had a lot of hit bands. How is it different? You say I want to see the live show today. Is that how it was in the past, or was it different in the past?
At Chrysalis, that was it. Chrysalis competed against Island. We all wanted to be A&M Records. That was our dream and goal, who mentored all of us. And I think at Chrysalis, whether we signed, you know, a bunch of us went up to Boston to see the Waterboys, which spawned World Party, which spawned Sinead O'Connor. The origins of the company were Procol Harum, 10 years after Jethro Tull, which then went into a Robin Trower, Pat Benatar era, which I wasn't around for, and then the Blondie era, and then the Billy Idol era, which I came into Spandau Ballet, Ultravox, and artists like that. But I think I try and emulate everything that went on in that era. So hence, my relationship with the Chris Wrights or the Jerry Mosses is like, what would they do? Or I asked them,
Chris Wright is half of Chrysalis, the other guy was Terry Ellis, and Jerry Moss is the M of A&M, for those who may not know.
So I would always, I say today, what would they do? And if I can't figure it out, I actually call them and try and see them.
Now, you had certain acts, you know, John Cicada, really more technotronic, Vanilla Ice, who had one very successful track. Now, that is not a paradigm we do not see in America. And our old friend Monty, who used to work for you, who has Universal Republic Records, he will sign one-hit wonders. I think Owl City was on his label.
Yes.
What can you tell? Let's say I'm Owl City, I'm making records in my basement, and I somehow get to Danny Glass, and I give you a track, you can know that it can get on the record radio immediately. However, there is no live history. What would you say or do?
Today, I would consider it. For the last 6 years, I wouldn't. We've passed on those huge records, and they've been with us first. I could name a few. I don't want to insult the artists, because then they're going to know I don't think they're good live, and I don't think they're good live. But there's been a few aberrations, a few anomalies. You know, one of them Monty had. And I just couldn't get inspired by seeing the artist live. And I think it would have hurt the roster. It would have hurt the balance, hurt our credibility at many levels. And I think in the artist relations world, we did the right thing. We don't have as much money maybe, but I think we did the right thing.
So what has changed now that you would make a deal like that?
Because I think we have a more substantial promotion team. We've beefed up quietly around the world, particularly in the UK, in Canada, US, where we can compete and on the occasion have a pop hot AC record, which is not the lane we really travel in our company. We don't profess to be in that lane. Majors just do a better job at us at that. But we actually can spread our wings out right now and I think have maybe one or two a year.
So you're saying it's really not an artistic choice, it's more the company direction that you want to go with live acts, career acts, credibility acts.
Yeah, no, because when you have your own company, you make your own rules. And to me, having friends or people I respect like you to invite you to a show is my greatest joy, whether it's family or friends. And if I don't want to invite you to the show, then I have an issue. Then it's like, you know, unless you could hear it in a spin class maybe, or someone hears it in a club and says, wow, I love you, got a banger, it's a cool record. But I'll leave that stuff to other people, and we will distribute labels like that with entrepreneurs, but it's really not gonna get into the Glassnote wheel, I don't think, in the next couple of years. It's gonna be tough.
Okay, so let's say you see my band live, and you're interested. What kind of contractual relationship will we enter into?
A pretty fair one. I mean, in general, we, you know, split everything with the artists 50-50. I mean, it's each deal is different, but the deal is really, if you do well, we do well, we do well, you do well. We don't really do a lot of royalty deals and get too smart with things, because we really want people to do well. And we do publishing deals also for some people we don't have on records. We do publishing deals for people we do have on record, but not exclusively. It's not mandatory. It's when we think we can do something for your career that our publishing guys, you know, really get involved. But I don't, there's no cookie cutter deal, but every deal's been fair. We've had one heavy negotiation in the history of the company, which got pricey. And I regret it. You know, we have the artists on the contract. I regret the negotiation, because nothing was gained during those 6 months of negotiation except they got more money. They recouped, which was good, but it was silly, because it shouldn't be about the money. Because if you bet on yourself, you'll both make money.
Okay, so you know, the conventional wisdom is that the major label is going to want a 360 deal. If I sign with Glassnote, am I going to give up touring, merch? Are you going to share all avenues of revenue?
No, very, very rarely. but we do, every single deal is different. I can't even think one is enough. I think we go down the line. The two things we do automatically is we have the merch for every band we have, because our general manager is a merch genius. He knows how to build merch, fund it, warehouse it, design it. He did the Beatles, and he did Sinatra, and he did, you know, stuff like that. So he's just great at it. So that's an asset we have in house. So we're just
slowing down there. So what percentage of merch that you sell in your bands is sold at the gig as opposed to third parties, whether it be regular retail, mail order, etc.?
As the artists build their career, it gets bigger to consumer, it gets bigger in stores, it gets bigger on the artist stores. In the beginning, 90% of it happens or more at the gig.
And in your act that has the greatest percentage outside the gig, that would be how much?
Oh, then it could go to the 40% probably.
So that's a lot.
Yeah. It could get up there. It could get to the 30, 40% range.
Okay,
yeah.
And then going back to one earlier point that you made, you said essentially it's a 50% deal. So whatever avenues of compensation they have, they're going to get 50% of net, generally speaking.
Not on every revenue stream. The music revenue side, record side, I think in general, each deal is different, but in general, I would say most independents cut 50-50 deals. And my friend and peer who just got honored, Martin Mills, has raised the issue in the press and privately.
Right, that's where I was going.
That we may have to examine the streaming income, which is 50-50 for guys like Beggars and us right now, and which we did way before the majors. I mean, the majors, you know,
haven't done it.
The majors have all kinds of weird stuff that goes on, but we're not in that world. We have to monitor, you know, month to month, because it's significant. The pendulum is swung. I mean, people have spoken, and I want to make sure we can make a living and pay everybody, and make sure we can give the tour support, and make sure we can get that photographer, videographer, because we still are the ATM. You know, the business 50 years ago is the same business today. The record company funds the beginning of the career.
Okay, so just to complete the thought, you said you have an in-house merch guy. You were talking about the 360 degrees of revenue. So you would take the merch. And now how about...
We ask for the merch.
Right.
Everybody has said yes. One artist said no, came back to us. If the capacity for the production gets too big, we will farm it out. And it's happened, thank goodness, three times already. We couldn't handle it. I mean, we're about to hit a point with Childish Gambino getting into, you know, significant evenings we're having with him now in merch. I mean, it just, the last few weeks have exploded, and we have our own guy on the road full time. You know, we pay for him. It's pretty amazing what's going on.
And how about publishing? Because I know you have your own publishing company. So if I sign a deal with you, what will the negotiation be relative to the publishing?
It's a separate meeting. In one case, the publishing company, Brandon, who runs our publishing company, he brought us an artist for a record, Jeremy Messersmith. We found as a writer, he's a friend, contemporary of Dan Wilson, great songwriter from Minneapolis, and the record was sort of the next part of the puzzle, happened to make a great record. So between our publisher sort of egging us on and two radio programmers, one from the Current in Minneapolis, Jim McGuinn, and Bruce Warren at WXPN, saying, you know, you've got the guy's publishing, you really should put this record out. We're thrilled we did. And, you know, last night I heard it on a Verizon spot, which was like amazing. So that's records, that's publishing, and Jeremy's happy because Jeremy gets paid a lot of money.
We're all happy when there's success. Until there's a lot of success, then we all argue. But all of a sudden, I'm successful, you're interested. What if I tell you you're interested, but also Jimmy Iovine's interested, Dan McCarroll, Warner Brothers is interested, what do you say?
I get pretty rude, because that is, I'm not sure of the word, that's probably the least motivating factor for me. It's a huge turnoff. You know, you either want to be with us or you don't. There are other independents who are great, but it really is apples and oranges, and that's the turnoff point for me. Nothing against Jimmy or Dan. I you know, they're great record guys, but if you're in the room with us, you want to see what we do for you, touring and promotion and marketing and support. That conversation doesn't go very far. We've walked away. We walked away from something last minute last year because of a major versus us. And I just said, go. And I actually called the CEO of the company and I said, stop negotiating, because you're negotiating against yourself. We're out. And he laughed. He said, thank you. And he's done okay. I don't think he's made money yet with the artist, but he's a friend of mine. And I'm very happy they're not with us, because they didn't belong with us.
So essentially, if there's a bidding war, or the advent of a bidding war, you take yourself out.
We're out most of the time. Yeah, because it's to us, it's the essence of the relationship with the artist and the manager and the agent, who are all part of the team, and the music, and we haven't really lost anything. If it gets into money, we're probably not the right company for it, because the after 3 years of being in business, I wanted us to not chase and hustle. I wanted the artists to be good enough and managers to be good enough as our reference. So that to me is what happened at A&M and in the Geffen heyday, and when Interscope was rolling and Def Jam was rolling. So to me, the only thing I tell people is, please speak to Phoenix, call Mumford and Sons, call Two Door Cinema Club, call Daughter, call Childish Gambino. And that to me is the referral. So if you're honest, you're paying your royalties, you support them, we do get things all over the media, that's people like that, but it's not really. What's the soul of a company? And if the soul of the company is something you want to be at, speak to them. And I think if they say bad things about us, then you shouldn't be with us.
And so, what about the fact that the barrier to entry to making music is lower than it's ever been? You and me can make a song and have it up on iTunes in hours, never mind tomorrow. How much incoming do you get, and what are the odds of the incoming actually reaching you and getting a good hear?
The incoming?
People want to be. People say, I have a record, I want us to be signed to Glassnote.
So the record being done, you're saying?
No, let me be clear. I'll expand it. There's, traditionally in the music business, there were a limited number of slots. It was expensive to make a demo or record. And the entry point for the last few decades is, I have a lawyer or a manager. And the lawyer or the manager would call you. If you know that lawyer or manager, whether personally, by reputation, you would certainly evaluate it. I assume that's still the case. But what about the people who said, I cut it in my basement, I went online, I found your address, I sent it to you. Is there any chance? Does anybody listen to that?
We listen to everything. It's a flaw that I have. It's a personality trait that I have. And actually, one of your letters, you wrote about a guy named Adam. He teaches at Wharton. He went to Michigan.
Yeah, right.
And Adam and I have the same disease, where we're too nice and we see everybody. We meet everybody.
His big thing, he responds to every email.
And he responded to my. We've actually been in contact now. And his roommate in college is a guy that I know pretty well. So we do listen to everything. We do get back to people. If it's a bogus, spam, ridiculous email, we'll just delete it.
Have you ever signed something that's come into your office 100% unsolicited?
Unsolicited in this last few years? I don't think so, no.
So the odds are still low for those who do not have a traditional relationship with a gatekeeper. Going further, you mentioned a few minutes ago when you were talking about the compatriot of Dan Wilson, about Jim McGuinn and these other radio guys saying to make a deal for records with that artist. You certainly have a long history with radio, but today, where does radio sit as piece of the puzzle today, and also the different elements of radio? Terrestrial radio, satellite radio, Pandora, Spotify, iTunes radio.
I think as important or more important than ever. I have been at the forefront of radio and a supporter of radio. I was one of the first believers in satellite radio. And we have a big live business. So I speak to club owners and promoters when I go walk in the club, or I go, whatever it's Bonnaroo or Coachella, Lollapalooza, Telluride, New Orleans Jazz, wherever I go, or I go to small clubs, and those clubs are being filled by people listening to Sirius XM. And I would say Spotify is very important. I think the advent now with iTunes radio, different forms of radio, which we didn't call before. The passive Pandora is a monster. Not something we have an interaction with that much, but it's there. It's big. So, but I think mentioning, going back to what's going on in different parts of the world, also Deezer. I just got back from France and different parts. Deezer is really important.
Deezer is, for all intents and purposes, the same as Spotify, but has huge market share in France and in other parts of the continent.
Yeah, so radio is a very broad word to me. I think Spotify is a form of radio. I think
well,
it's
then
a
let
huge,
me rephrase the question.
Radio.
How important is traditional terrestrial radio?
I think it's very important. I think it's there's a fear of it. There's an ignorance of it. There's a confusion. There's a lot of stigma attached to how to work it. It goes through these ebbs and flows, but you know, looking at Childish Gambino the last 5 weeks, the game changer of filling up the rooms from 3,000 to 6,000 people has been radio. The difference of Phoenix's career, we took us 58 weeks to break 1901, radio. What happened there, and then it gets bigger. Certain artists, Mumford & Sons was a little bit of everything. It was live, it was word of mouth, it was blogs, it was huge iTunes love, and you know, particularly in Canada.
Can we be, we have a limited amount of time, so otherwise I wouldn't interrupt you. Can you be successful, never mind at your label, but in the music business in general, can you break through without terrestrial radio?
Rarely, rarely. I think there are live bands that do build followings. You know, we had jam band era before that. We had metal stuff that went on. It's rare to really break through. Now, most of our roster is not radio oriented. We sign left of center music. You go to see Childish Gambino 4 years ago, you can't think about radio. You go to see Mumford & Sons, you got a kick drum, a banjo, and the F word. What are you kidding? In the first 90 days, the door was shut. Phoenix, French band from Versailles, three records which peaked at 29,000 units.
But you're a
people don't want to touch it.
You're a brilliant guy with a long history. When you see those bands, do you say, I will eventually get
yes,
them on the radio?
Yes, yes. I see two things. What I was taught at Chrysalis, what I was taught by people like Jerry, and is if you don't see that arena and you don't hear it on certain radio stations around the world, you should walk out of the room. They told me that. Walk out of the room if you don't see them one day playing that big room. And I have walked out of the room. It's happened to me. I've had epiphanies in that room and saying, in the club, and saying to my team, let's get out of here. And they said, really, why? I said, because this is a hype. We're getting, this is all an A&R, you know, BS, you know, festival.
Well, is it also possible you see a band that's really great live, but you say, just can never hear this music on the radio, and therefore I'm just not going to make a deal?
No, because I don't think radio knows. Radio did not want to play mostly anything. Radio didn't want to play Daughter. A guy named Laszlo in Kansas City started playing Daughter. It's a sin. If you go to a spin class, you go to a club, you hear Youth by Daughter. Go to a concert, you see people crying. You see them know every lyric. The band is massive. They tour with the National. They get 10, 15,000 people. Radio, I'm not upset, but radio's going to catch up. And in the third album, they'll be all over Daughter. Churches. Why is Churches not on the radio? People just missing it. They're just missing it because probably a female lead, probably because they don't want that many females on their rock station. They're overly consulted. They're idiots. So it's going to take time, but I have the patience, the fortitude, and the belief in the band, so I keep inviting them. I invited some of those geniuses to see the band over the weekend. Then I flew out to LA, and they saw Church. I said, whoa, what did we miss? But you have visionaries like Rick Krim at VH1 who said, I get it. And that's what it catches up. You can't have a chip on your shoulder. You've got to get along with people, and eventually they come around if the band is great. So it's about belief, it's about tenacity, it's about patience, patience, patience. And I think what separates us from everybody else is we respect media, we trust media, but we are the slowest company probably in the world. And I think that's a great trait. Very good trade. Most people may not want to be with us. They may want a quick hit. They shouldn't come with us for that.
Okay, let's talk about your company. Don't take this the wrong way. Your company is Daniel Glass and a bunch of nobodies. Whereas these other companies say, oh, I have this person, I have that person, and that person. You are legendary for being a mentor. When I've been to your office, I haven't been for a couple of years, but basically everybody's in a room, everybody's under 30. So can you talk about your hiring philosophy, your mentoring philosophy, and how you motivate people essentially with no history, not only in your present team, but over decades, to be superstars in their field?
They're still under 30. I've got one adult in the company, our general manager, who's the guy in charge of it. Chris Scully is an amazing partner to me, and he's great. Two people are here today, and you find great music people who want to be with you. You find those passionate people. I have not had good luck with hiring one or two people made my life from a major label. And that's sad, because they've been demoralized or merged or consulted or their habits. I don't need those preconceived notions. So there's not a political day in our company where someone comes in the way we did it. There's no we did it because they don't know. So they don't know anything.
Right.
And that's beautiful. So if you look at our team, The innocence is, I want to be with you, I want to be with the company. So then we start training. Nick Petropoulos, who had a promotion, just won promotion guy of the year 2 years in a row at the Musexpo, or whatever it's called. What's it called?
Musexpo.
No, before that. all, what's it called? Worldwide Radio Summit. Nick won 2 years in a row.
It's Sat's thing.
Sat's thing. He was sweeping the floors at Red. He was an intern in his mid.
Red is an independent distribution arm that's actually owned by Sony.
And he loved Phoenix. He loved specialty. We've now groomed him. He's now a multi-format superstar in promotion. Our head of marketing, my son introduced me. He met her at Summit Series in Utah, my son Sean. And she said, you got to meet this girl. She was working for, she was on Capitol Hill. Then she went to work at Sweetgreens, which is an organic food chain. She booked Sweet Life Festival. We found her, head of marketing, genius. Our aesthetic has finally improved to the level of an A&M or a Chrysalis because of her. And she's, I put her up against anybody.
Let's just assume, for whatever reason, I'm now in your office for an interview. What am I going to say that's going to turn you on, say, I want this person?
You have to want to be with us really, really badly. You have to want to be with this team of people, this family. You have to want to be there 7 days a week with our artists. You have to be able to turn desks over, as I say it metaphorically, but I actually mean it, because I have turned desks over. If any of you have been with me, I've been thrown out of venues, I've been thrown out of radio stations, I've been thrown out of clubs, because if I believe in something, I'll go all the way. I'll fight for the artist, I'll fight for the person to a fault. I have to feel that from you. I have to feel, I like people who failed. I think those are people that I like when they get up off the ground, because I've certainly failed. I've been fired, and you helped me through a tough time, and it just made me, you know, I think in the cliche of who I am. So it's really that spirit of people who go up against it and against all odds. We're not supposed to win. We're not supposed to have the slot. Everybody wants us out. The majors don't pray for us to succeed. They want us to fail. I know that. But we go into the fissures and the crevices and the cracks, and we get in our way, but it's the belief of the artist. And again, the marketing plan, take people to see the artist live. That is our plan. That's the whole marketing plan in one line.
So, as you sit in your perch, what do you see as the future in your business? I'm talking less about what type of music, but will it continue to be terrestrial radio driven? Will the major labels continue to have power? Speak to that.
Well, we've just made a new deal with Universal, so we are 100% independent.
Just to be clear, they distribute records
around the world. We have been distributed. My career, I have been friends with Randy Lennox, who's the chairman and, of Universal up here, since the beginning. But it was through an independent relationship. It was Chrysalis Records. So everything I've done has been with Randy and his team, and he treats independence as on the same level as everybody else, which is why he wins awards, which is why he's the guy. So that relationship really carried across the world. And then Lucien Grange respects entrepreneurs and independents. I don't know what my other friends have as far as deals, but we've got a very fair deal to now grow our company. The future is having the vision and respect for new things, not to be morons of the idiots who shut Napster down, but it's to embrace the ethical, good services, and I think there's a lot of them coming, and a lot of them out right now, thriving. Embrace them. We will make money. Our streaming income is very good. Our sound exchange money is fantastic. So it's just different checks that are coming in. But the live business is booming. I think that I have a lot of faith in the business. I think lean is better, not bloated. I think there's a problem with that. We have to make the record company experience a little bit more rock and roll again and enjoyable for a 21-year-old kid who's a junior or a senior in college to want to go back to the music industry and the record business and not fly out to Palo Alto. We need that guy and girl to come to us, which is why I try and create that mini scene, which is a mini version of, I just visited Shazam, Dropbox, the iTunes Cupertino office because I was with my son on a college tour. It's more fun. It's more fun. You come to our office, you're not going to be bored. The music is cranking, you can have a great time. You go to our London office, it may be in a pretty chic area, but it's happening, it's in Mayfair. And we've got five people in that office, five adults, well, they're under 30, but they're adults to me. The place is wild. And we're all over Radio 1, we're all over XFM, we're all over Radio 6, we're all over NME. We put the money in, and now we've got a happening company there.
Just go a minute or two longer, we're at the end of our time. So, one word, why is Daniel Glass successful?
Last year's word was inspired. So I spent the entire year trying to get our team and myself inspired. Not, it's hard to get yourself inspired. I run every day, but I went to places all over the world. I went to Marrakesh because I got to meet Keith Richards, and I asked him, where'd you get it? He told me to go to Marrakesh. I went to Marrakesh. I actually did that. I met him at a party for 2 seconds, and I said, where did you get inspiration? Marrakesh. So I booked a trip to Marrakesh with my wife. And that, if you ever smell or look at the colors of that town, you will be inspired. I went to Florence, Italy, and I saw a video installation by an American artist named Bill Viola. And my wife thought I was lost. I was in the back of this museum for hours. And that inspired me. So that was the whole thing of last year. I try to get everybody to read the New York Times on Sunday and get inspired. Bob has heard my speech. You don't read the Sunday New York Times, you're probably gonna get fired if you work for us. So this year, the two words, well, the one was proactive and confidence mixed with arrogance. That's what I'm trying to instill in our staff. Proactive with confidence mixed with arrogance. But my wife's word, which she said to me, don't be afraid to use it, is relentlessness, relentless. And that's probably what I am right now. If you sign with us or you are mentored by me or somebody, relentless.
Wouldn't one argue, those of us who know, that you've always been relentless?
I'm more inspired now, though, because I think this is, I wasn't around in the 60s for that unbelievable burst of the British invasion. I wasn't around for that burst. It's happening now. This is unbelievable how fair, how equal it is, the footing. This is the greatest, greatest time. I had an amazing moment coming into Chrysalis. I had an amazing moment being a disco DJ. This here, right now, I'm addicted to festivals. I'm addicted to the worldwide business. I'm excited about South America. We're in the middle of something just phenomenal right now. How much easier it is to read the tools available to us. So I am really, really, really optimistic. But your letter says it every week. If you're just good, or you're very good, or almost great, you should probably get out. Because we were able to fluff it in the 80s, somewhat in the 90s. Can't do it anymore. You can't do it. You're naked. You are really naked. So go into another part of the business. If you love the music thing, do something else. It's sad, you know. But it's not sad. It's real. Actually, I'm kind of happy in a way.
Okay, before I let you go, though, we were talking last Saturday night, and you said, if you're not top 30 in iTunes, forget it.
Tough chart, iTunes. You know, a lot of what I do, I follow my three kids. I talked about my wife, and my three kids kind of guide me in almost everything I do. Very interesting kids. They have different traits, as all children do. But I watch my youngest son troll and fish and skim the waters, and he says to me, if you're below that 30 or 40, you're in Siberia, and you've got to get up there, and it's true. You've got to get in that carousel. You've got to get in that wheel. Almost everything. It's that way in life, by the way. If you're a student, if you're a clothing designer, you got to get racked. You got to get. You can't. You've got to get it up there. And there's ways to do it around it, supporting the music. But in iTunes, very tough to be in the 70s and the 80s and the 90s. It's just not a land you want to be in. But it also wouldn't be there at a retail store 20 years ago. You know, if you were at a Tower or HMV, you got to find it. But you know what? You find it, and the word of mouth starts. But that's a tough retail place to be if you're not in the top 30.
Well, obviously, this has been fascinating, and I'll give you the one thing. If you ever get anybody's ear you really want to hear, don't badger them. We can talk to Daniel for hours, but I think this is a natural stopping point. He's given us a lot of nuggets of stimulation. He's going to continue to work today. He's not going to the spa. And hopefully you've been inspired by this speech. All for Daniel Glass here.
Thank you.